Dear friends, we continue work. Now we have had a very interesting, engaging discussion. I was following all the presentations, all the interventions, and I think that there is some kind of dissatisfaction, certain feeling of pessimism, which was displayed throughout the first plenary session. But I believe this is quite normal. The forum is a holistic event. During the first plenary session, we try to summarize the results of the 25 years of the reforms, and you cannot do without pessimism. I would like to debate with Mr. Professor Greenberg. He started the discussion from declaring the results of the sociological survey, where he said that over 50% of the population of Russia stand for a return of the planned economy, and he believes that this is a negative fact.
Well, I would like to offer to you a chance of interpreting this desire of the people.
I think that
people do not want to return to the past experience. They want to see a more active role of the government. Our people see great potential for development, and they are not satisfied with the status of the economy and their life, which they see around them, and they want changes. And I saw results of another survey where 65% of this respondents say they want changes, and the key of the changes in new economic policy, they see new industrialization. And we have the pleasure in this panel representative of the real sector of the economy, industrialists, and we will discuss now positive scenarios of the development. And on the right, or the right hand of me, left hand side of yours, there's a table with the document which is now under the name Charter 2016, the Charter of Resurrection of Russia, and we speak in that charter about the need of the day, what should be changed in this country, the economy. We want this economic change. So if you're in agreement with this approach, kindly sign under the petition, and I think this Charter 26 is a non-binding document, of course, but it unites people ideologically, and they think this charter can be added with your contribution. You may add, propose amendments, and we will, after that, all the amendments are considered, we'll propose it, make it public. So we are considering the positive scenario of the development in Russia, and I believe it is possible in Russia, and it is possible. It's time for to implement that. How to implement that, and what exactly we're supposed to do, we'll be discussing. I would like to give the first floor to the most beautiful representative of our panel, Oksana Dmitrieva. You have the floor, Oksana. Thank you. The time schedule is 5 minutes for each presentation, then I would now like to my presentation to be shown on the monitor, on the screen. Thank you. Dear colleagues, I understand that in the first plenary session, they had a very heated debate, and they discussed world challenges. For a positive scenario, I would like to say a few words as to what is the type of a crisis, what type is the Russian crisis which we're going through. This is a crisis of 2014-2016, just for the sake of convenience. Let us give these years. The devaluation of the national currency, which is the key indicator of the today's status, is indeed not a factor of a crisis, but a factor of growth, but under certain conditions. Cheap credit, tax breaks, and growth of the income available with the households and the government. Then let us speak about our crisis. Well, The world has never seen a crisis of this kind, because in the world practice there is not a crisis, the reduction of production, growth of unemployment against the following background, growth of the income, revenue 153% in 2015. So that means that revenue grew by 1.5. So, well, the investments went down by 91%. The growth of deposits of organizations between 2014 and 2016, the growth rate is 170. No bankruptcies. The economy is simply abundant with money, but they are not being used. The growth of M2 phenomena is only 6%. What in so doing, we should say that if someone would measure the rate of circulation of money, would notice that this rate is very, velocity is very low, like turtle one. The growth of the retail turnover is 90% reduction, loss of the real wages less than minus 10%. There are many recipes as to that the economy should be imbued with money. Let us look where the money is and how much we have. Over 2014, 2015, the growth of credits 135%, growth of deposits 141%. All in all, in the system, organizations have the growth of credit 142 and growth of deposits is 170. The population growth of credit is 107, but deposits 126. So in fact, there is a repumping of funds from the real sector into the virtual sector, where it circulate against itself. So the deposits and credits, and there is a pumping of real funds from the real sector of the economy. And now, let us look at the positive scenario. The necessary condition for going out, finding a way out of the crisis, if it is amendment crisis, is to take away from the management of those people who created the crisis. So the key thesis is hands off the economy of those who cannot manage the, do not know how to manage the economy. What should be done, in my opinion? Very briefly, whatever government is doing, central bank should be done with an absolute opposite way. The credit policy should be negative scenario, which is current scenario, is costly credit, 14-20% interest rate, and the key interest rate is between 70-11%. What should be done? Cheap credits at the interest rate of 7-8%, and the key rate should be 5-6%. The world practice shows a lot of examples of the negative bank margin, but our country have never seen such a great, huge banking margin. You will never be able to find, say, countries with a bank margin where the bank will have a margin of 3%. Now our banks have 5-7%. How to do that? There may be various mechanisms involved, but the target should be like that. Monetary policy with the exchange rate fluctuates with the price of the oil. What should be done? You should conduct a stable policy of cheap ruble. This is now where the price of oil is going up. You can perform this maneuver, fixed ruble at a certain level, which would give priority to domestic producers at the level of allowing, competition advantage, tax breaks, stimulation of production through taxes. Negative scenario, which is the fact, increase of taxes, platoon, quasi-payments, enhancement on the levies, taxes laid on properties, and increase of insurance payment on small-scale business. The positive scenario is reduction of taxes, moratorium, and reduction of taxes, resurrection of the investment tax breaks on the income tax. Investment process should be stimulated if there is any income, but there is no investment process. So you have to reintroduce the investment advantage based on the income. Household income. You see a real reduction of the household income over the last, 15 years, starting from the year 2000. So this is a very grave, impediment to the growth of economic growth because there is no paid demand. You have to, index. Whatever government does, prorated to inflation rate, the governmental demand, same thing. The state demand, we see the reduction of the investment less for 8.4%. This is aided by those who manage, well, basically they call it investments in the budget, but it's not an investment. It's an investment into charter capital, foundation capital of various joint stock companies, and they retain the deposits, or this is the stated use of the funds of the national welfare, but it doesn't percolate down to real investments because these funds remain on as deposits. And my last item, which a point which I would like to make, is the state order, which does not serve as a stimulus but as a break. You should reject the practice of auction of tenders and go in for a state contract, stabilize in terms of the prices and the term. This is what business asks for. And where are the sources for to finance such a beautiful scenario, indexation of expenses and on the hand, the decline of the taxes? The source is the 1.3 trillion rubles, which have been taken of the budgetary funds and which place on deposits in banks as a help the bank system, and also the fund of national welfare. Those are, and because this money does not percolate down to the real investment process. Thank you. The next speaker I would like to give to the person who does not need any introduction. He is a world-known scientist, jurist Alferov. First of all, when you started your introduction, you mentioned to optimists and pessimists, and now it's time for optimistic proposals. I think, remember 15 years ago when I received the Nobel Prize and I presented lectures in the Stockholm universities, Swedish universities, they were very excited about, concerned about the situation in Russia, asked me about about the status of science and ecology in Russia, and I told them that Russia was a country of optimism because all pessimists had left the country already. Well, I see that the pessimists continue to leave the country, but Russia still remains a state of pessimism. For me, the most remarkable person in the 20th century, not only in the sphere of science, but also as in terms of historical importance, is Albert Einstein. What he did in 1905 by publishing at the age of 26 years five works, which overturned the modern science at that time and became the foundation of the modern physics. Well, you know what I'm referring to, words I refer to. And this year we observed the 100th anniversary of another year where he published three work, general theory of relativity and theory of stimulated transitions, which became the foundation of all laser-based technology. But all, very few know that Albert Einstein was always interested in economics, and in 1949 he wrote a large article as why socialism. Why socialism? Where he showed that the private ownership on the means of production, which occurred not as a result of the through economic means, but as a way of capture, gave born economic oligarch circles. It described the status of the capitalist society of 1949. It resembles very much what we have in this country now. And Albert Einstein would say that the way out of the situation is socialism. Let me cite. I invite you to find it because there's good. Unlimited competition results in huge spending of human labor and mutilating of human conscience of individual. This mutilation is something which I believe the greatest evil of the capitalist system. Our system of education suffers from this evil. Our participation is imbued with the level of competition as a preparation for a career. Young people are taught to believe in success. I believe it is one way to get rid of those evils and to by creating socialist economy and corresponding system of education, which would be in line with the attainment of the public objectives. This economic of where the economy where the means of production belong to the entire society and are used according to a plan. We should be remembered that planned economy is not a socialism per se. It can be, accompanied by total enslavement of human being. These days, we're facing a very difficult challenge. The science, per se, does never determine objectives. The science gives means for attaining goals. It is the group of people who think about that determine objectives. But right now, in the present situation, it is necessary for us to develop high-tech sectors of the economy. And in this respect, I fully endorsed what President Putin says. I discussed with him several times when he spoke about the necessity of 25 million of jobs until 2020. He formulated it as a business task, and I would formulate it as also as a task for education and science, because that attainment of this goal would call for a different type of education, for a different type of scientific research, and it's very important. Intuition should help us there. Reform of the science, which was made without discussion with scientists from top down, in fact, afflicted a great damage to development of this science. The key problem of our science is that it is not required, demanded for by our society and our calculations. So we have to change the economic model of development. And when the science is called for, then let us not forget questions asked, what Soviet, I received the Nobel Prize for the formulation of modern economic confession technology, which was the silicon chips, which was used by Fieldby and had a structure we had by us, determined the development. Let us not forget about our flight, and the Il-76 has never had any, accident. I'm not speaking about outer space exploration. Our system, the 10 ministers of the military and industrial complex could have become a transnational company occupied with any foreign companies. And to do that, we should not create God of the market economy, but should understand that the market is one of the mechanisms which is implemented in a strategic planning of the development of the country as a whole. Thank you very much indeed.
To summarize, are you an optimist or you are a pessimist? Do you believe that the modern form of capitalism could be rearranged and could be used for further development? I was invited to work in the United States in 1971, and after that, dozens of times. I'm here. I created a brilliant university where we use the new system of education. Of course, I am an optimist. During our previous discussion, it was said the Russian could create something unique only once, but they could not repeat it from day to day and year to year, replicating that. Here, we have president of Technonikol company manufacturing construction materials for roofing and insulation. What they produce today, you can wrap the globe six times. And these are materials of top quality. Sergei Anatolievich Kolesnikov, the floor is yours. Thank you for such encouraging words. And we have created 40 enterprises. We are a private enterprise. We export to 49 countries of the world. And we have 21 representative offices in Eurasia and other places. We have a standard product. These are general construction materials, heat insulation, and roofing materials. Yes, we could manufacture standardized products and Robert of Schuchert and other managers to standardize procedures and processes. What we did, we acquired European technologies, some ways to organize labor and achieve those results. Of course, we stubbornly and persistently work, and we could demonstrate that you could build stable enterprises with the high wages. We have average wages is 46,000 rubles, which is twice as big as the average all over the country. Last year, we also finished with growth, and export continues to be. And today's rate of exchange is also a plus to us, around 86 rubles per euro, which makes our products competitive. And we supply this product even to China. And we could successfully compete and take advantage of this rate of exchange, even sell products in China. What impedes our development, and I heard about that in Sochi, Mr. Galeski spoke about this. The owner of Magnet, definitely the change of legislation is a negative factor. Of course, these changes, they fall on our head. I work in the public organization, the Business Russia, and take part in the discussion. And we adopt more than 500 bills a year. And again, the latest one, the code of legal violations. New inhibitions are being used in different fines, which are extremely larger as compared with the previous one. And sometimes the company could be deprived of their license without even the decision of the court. And all these initiatives, they are coming from the federal bodies. And of course, for them, it is easier for them to control our activity. But for us, we are losing our rights for free enterprise. And this puts more pressure on us. And of course, what needs to be done is abort those initiatives of the government with the, let's say, code of 1,600 pages. And I'm afraid that this document will be adopted silently, and we will be facing a big problem once it is published. Again, the court system where economic disputes couldn't be discussed in the courts of general jurisdiction. So these amendments should be made, and I believe it might be of use. Thank you. I would like to give the floor to Mr. Reinert, a very well-known Norwegian economist, and about 10 years ago, he wrote a book, How Rich Countries Became Rich and Why Poor Countries Remain Poor. And he demonstrated that not free trade and the use of natural advantages as natural resources lead the countries to development, but protectionism and processing industry. That is a book which is known in the world, and many scientists change their viewpoint. Mr. Reiner, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here again. I think one of my advantages is that I've been working in a lot of countries. Last time I had a count was that I've been active either as a businessman or as an economist in 59 countries, which gives some kind of experience. And what was discussed in the first round was what was wrong with economics. And I think, you know, one of the things which is wrong with economics is that it's a science void of context and experience. So I'll concentrate, my starting point is one of the words used by Mrs. Strauss-Kahn, diversification. I think if you look at Russian history, which I have had the pleasure of doing with a study from the Expert magazine I did a few years ago, Russia has had two very successful experiences, and diversification out of the agricultural sector has been key to both. The first was the story of Peter the Great, industrialization and infrastructure, you know, getting out of only agriculture and diversifying into industry. The second round was that of Sergei Vite, who I understand one of the sponsors of this conference is named after. Vite took his teachings from German economist Friedrich List, who he translated. And Vite's idea was essentially the same as Peter the First. It was diversification and infrastructure, in his case, canals. A very interesting story I came around recently was that when the Bolsheviks took over, what they took over almost without changing was the unit that Sergei Vite had built up for industrialization of Russia. So in a sense, the Bolsheviks also made their development strategy based on Friedrich List. And if you are a stamp collector as I am, you find that both East Germany and West Germany published stamps in the honor of Friedrich List, and in that sense also Sergei Vite. So I think we have come to think of the two parts of capitalism, of the Cold War, as being very different. You know, communism and capitalism. Well, communism and capitalism wasn't really that different. They were both based on mass production of and industrialization, right? And what happened with neoliberalism was that, you know, we got the idea it doesn't matter what you produce. So the success story was the same on both sides of the Berlin Wall. And I'm of the opinion that globalization is not going to continue. Globalization in the first round stopped around 1900 when it was no longer in the interest of England. If you look at the US system today, you find that the candidates who are the outsiders, Mr. Sanders and Mr. Trump, representing in a sense the extreme left and right, they are both for protecting the US industry. So I think there's something to learn here for Russia. You know, don't don't steer after the rear mirror of the car, you know. Don't steer after the wake of the boat. See where the boat is heading. And the boat is heading into what was decided in 1947, that the best thing, you know, with the Marshall Plan, was divide manufacturing industry to all nations. And when time comes, you go for free trade, right? So I'm all for free trade. It's the timing of the free trade which is the problem. And if you look at what happened to Russia in the 1990s, when real wages fell by 50%, manufacturing industry collapsed by 50%, agriculture also collapsed by 50%. You know, that was premature free trade. And I think you're still trying to recover from that case of premature free trade. You know, I'm a graduate of Harvard Business School, so I can quote Karl Marx. And Marx is supposed to have said in 1848 that he was very much in favor of free trade, because free trade at the long time would promote revolution. And I think if we look at what's happening in the Middle East, we have to look at the GDP of Iraq, which fell from $7,000 per capita per year to $2,000. You know, the other countries don't have good strategy. But what we know from experience is that deindustrialization hurts the middle class, and deindustrialization will sooner or later create reindustrialization. And I think that's what's happened in England in 1900. That's what's now happening again in the United States. Also in the United States, by the way, male life expectancy is falling, just like in Russia in the 1990s. And this was a big scandal now, just before Christmas, in the United States. So, you know, the free trade that made such a toll on the Russian economy in the 1990s is making its toll also elsewhere, also in the periphery of Europe. So the problem is, how do we have reasonable transitions into free trade? And I think here Russia needs some plan. You know, you have a very good success story with poultry industry, with chickens. You got rid of the bush legs by a good economic policy. I think you can get that economic policy also in other areas. And it's not only high tech. High tech is good. It doesn't produce a lot of jobs. That's the problem. So you need high tech, but you also need manufacturing of the kind we've already heard about. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Reinert. It's very important, and I think we heard the thought exposed by Mr. Truskan. Russia shouldn't look similar like other countries, but should rely on its own traditions and try to create something of their own. And there are certain examples, like excellent aircraft evolution, 86, we got scientific schools and move across the way of our own. Next speaker, Mr. Io, is the man who is involved in agricultural production and at the same time also joins political processes at the municipal level, and how the ideas which were exposed here, how it works right on the in your region. Thank you. I would like to use my presentation here, and if there are any positive scenarios for Russia's development, I think we don't have any. Taking the examples of Primorsky Krai, the agricultural manufacturers is paying 556, and last year our governor increases the price of land 30 times. And even the holder of a garden having 6 acres of land will have to pay a lot. And you can imagine how much money the agricultural manufacturer should have to pay. in Primorsky region, perhaps many agricultural manufacturers will go bankrupt. We have a Chinese neighbor in our state is selling electricity at the price of 1.5. To Chinese, we are sending them electricity 1.5, and we are paying 5.5. Chinese banks have a rate of exchange is 1.2%. How could we compete with Chinese if our own state has such a tremendous amount of interest? We are talking about insurance and everything also. And when we sell our product and at the same time we have the product manufactured by our neighbors, of course, which is much cheaper. Across the border, we have a Chinese city, and in 20 years, from a village is turned into a city with the 3,000 people population. They have their shopping windows very well illuminated, and even if we exceed the amount of energy, we will be fined for excess use of electricity, and you have to leave a lot of money for different clearances and permissions, and there is a lot of corruption in this. Here in Moscow, how could we attract population to the Far East? There's no need to invent anything. The basic solutions are on top. Give us this money and different privileges to the local people, and we will not think how to leave this place and go to Moscow. In 2012, they have initiated a program for pipeline gas supplies to local populations, but still this program is not working. And I think the bureaucrats hates a simple citizen and what they have invented. If you want to get a patch of land with forests so that if this procedure is organized so the local population is unaware that these selling procedures are effective. And the land is being sold to large buyers. And I have one village in this settlement where the local bureaucrats helped the rich people to buy adjacent land, and the forest is on lease, and they don't have enough space for the cows to get their grass around, because these villages are surrounded by private land. And the loans were also offered to the population, and people started to be large debtors. And our deputies, they limit the rights of those who borrowed the money, and they are not allowed to go abroad. Their driving license is also deprived. The next step will be the deprivation of the civil rights. If you owe the bank, so you will be deprived. So it means that tomorrow people may become slaves.
But it's really convenient to manage a country which the population of which is deprived of civil rights. So I stand for the change of the economic course of our country, for the charter of the development of Russia, for reduction of tariffs for power, reduction of the prices for fuel. I stand for the program for resurrection of villages, for the program of actually working in face of the favor of agriculture. And any government official before taking a position, government should work either in agriculture or industry, and then he will say respect the agriculturists and people of who toil in the land. When there was one of the, I want to, they say water from taps, and indeed, in my villages, the majority of the population have water which is brought to them twice a day, once a week actually, and they accumulate it. So in what century do we live? People do not have fresh water. They cannot take shower every day. They take it only once a week. We are deprived of water resources there. I think water, electricity, fuel, should be given to the people of our country, and we'll be able to work hard. This is my opinion. Thank you for your patient hearing. Okay, I see by your applause what you think about this presentation. Initially, I was about to become optimist, but to understand that in such conditions, you still are able to sow, say, plants and grow rice. That means that under a serious and a real logic, economic policy will be able not only to compete with the Chinese neighbors, but to feed the entire world with your products, not only Russia. Now I have the pleasure of giving the floor to Valeriy Ivan Ushachev. He is the director of the Russian Research Institute for Agricultural Economy. You have the floor. Thank you, considering the fact that Konstantin Anatolievich sticks to the asks to stick to the timetable. I invite you to start my presentation before speaking about the various scenarios of development of the agri-industrial complex and our vision of the future. It would be proper to assess the level of its development, where we stand at the moment. At present, the agriculture is one of the few branches of the economy which has been showing actual growth for the second year in a row. The growth rate is about 3.1% on the annual. This is very good indeed, but this is a growth and not development. We need to have a development. But if we look at the 1990, we on the whole in our agricultural halls have not yet reached the pre-reform level of the development, and the lagging behind is about 20%. This is confirmed by the foodstuff segments. In terms of grain, we are in the year 1970. At that one time, we received 170 tons of grain. In terms of milk production, we are in the year 1957. Then we received 31 million tons of milk. Now we have 30 million tons. The only exclusion is that we are developing pork industry and poultry. In terms of poultry, we have the growth by the magnitude of 2.5. The reasons for that are four or five. Reduction by one-third of arable land used for agricultural production. Secondly, low profitability of the majority, I emphasize, of agriculturists. Third, limited access of financial and other resources and the high price. Fourth, low productivity of labor. And the fifth factor, investment hunger, deficit of investment. The volume of investments in the industry, our industry, in our sphere, Over the last 2 years, the volume of the reduction of the investment in our sphere was 15%. But taking into account the ongoing financial situation, the issue of making a valuable investment crisis, or crisis per se, has become the topic of the day. Despite the fact the government has taken certain measures, nevertheless, the volume of investment credits in plant growing reduced last year by the margin of 20%, and the animal husbandry by 11%. And access to credits is given only to a limited number of producers who have high profitable. Only 27% of producers, and they are they generate 95% of the total revenues received, income received in the agriculture. And what to do with the low-income organizations? They do not have access to credits. On top of that, macroeconomic situation is not conducive for development of the agricultural sector. I mean, reduction of the disposable income of the population by 5%, with the increase of the consumer prices last year by 15.5%, which resulted in the household demand by 10%. And proceeding from that, let us structure think of the prospects of the agricultural sector. There may be a number of scenarios. The first is inertia, scenario of inertia, where production of agriculture over the next 15 years would grow to the same extent as until now. In our quintile calculations, if this scenario is implemented, then in terms of the milk will be consumed per capita 230 kilograms, where the medical norm is 330 kilograms. But the situation will be okay with as far as the pork meat and poultry meat is concerned. In terms of implementation of this scenario, our present will become our future. Secondly, this scenario is not acceptable for us. We do not take it, adopt it. The second scenario, which is debated presently quite widely in the expert community, it's again, we start from the deeper liberalization of land laws. I don't know how far we may go. Creation of large holdings with direct foreign capital and ending of the transition by the A21 to 3D printing of synthetic meat. This is a scenario debated widely. I do not even comment on that. We adhere to the direction which was expounded in the roadmap of development of the industries of the agricultural sector prepared by scientists in the agricultural sector together with a group of Konstantin Babkin. According to that scenario, we believe that in the sphere of land relations, it should be necessary to form a system under which the key producers, and not only a few of them, would be owners of land. Secondly, form in the sphere of the forms of activity, business activity, harmonic development of various legal forms, their cooperation integration. Thirdly, in terms of economic relations, creation of conditions conducive for sufficient profitability of agriculture and transition to innovative technologies. And fourthly, in terms of social policy, integrated approach, systemic approach, I mean development of social and engineering infrastructure, jobs, demography, diversification of agricultural economy, bringing together conditions of living conditions of city, urban, and agricultural dwellers. And speaking about development of the agriculture complex, what we need today is a long-term vision of the development of our industries. In this connection, we should do, and we are already doing that as a matter of fact, development of the strategy of social economic development of agro-industrial complex. And those, and the solution of those issues will call for scientific research and wide range discussion in the expert community. Thank you for your patient hearing. Thank you, Ivan Grigorievich. You mentioned, in fact, that in terms of the grain ware in the year 2070, in terms of milk in the year 1957, that I would like, it's necessary to understand that over the last 25 years, the other countries of the world has experienced the agricultural revolution. They doubled the volume of the agricultural produce over the last 25 years. We, as a matter of fact, went back and we missed, 200% growth. So if we are able to make use of our potential, we'll have a right a long way to go to the future, and nothing should prevent us from using those good chances which the nature and history give to us. Now to have the pleasure, I have the pleasure of inviting Mr. Strezhnev. He is the president of Technochem, EuroChem company, producers of fertilizers, one of the largest producers. They invest in the modernization of their progress, a billion dollars every year. Dmitry Stepanovich, you have the floor. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Babkin. Dear colleagues, I represent a developing company which is doing business fine. We invest to Russia $1 billion in terms of direct investments. At the same time, we implement three projects, which is each of which costs more than $1 billion. And in the year 2018, we are optimists. We are doomed optimists, and we put it this way. And not only we appear to Russia, but we have plants in China, in Belgium, in Lithuania. We're building a production facility in the United States. So looking at what is taking place in other countries of the world, especially in China, which has transformed its economy, we can only wish all of us a few simple things which could help us. And so that may convert people into optimists. What exactly I have in mind? Number one, we should stop administrative itch to interfere with the business. It takes place everywhere. All reforms and up in a situation when the situation is worse than it used to be. But still, there are a few things, some positive things. Why a country started to live in the year 2000? Well, as a matter of fact, Mr. Comrade Primakov made a very simple tax reform and say released the constraints on the ruble-dollar exchange rate. And the number of checks and supervision of the business was brought down to minimum. So I would stop all those administrative wrongdoings for the period of 5 to 10 years and sustain attractive exchange rate. And based on the, and within the 3 or 5 years would sort out all the things in a calm atmosphere. Second proposal, there is no easy recipe, but we should cut the cloth according to our means. If a government would give me as to a businessman a lot of funds, but we, government does not have funds, we cannot anticipate any, so government cannot give access to resources to all. I would even say that if there is a subjective access to resources, they will not be given to those who really need them. So in terms of the support of investors, I would act rationally. Should set up simple rules of getting investment breaks. I would say liberate from obligations to pay taxes when if you build a new facility, you have to pay taxes to the stock exchequer. You cannot liberate everyone, so that because that might we can get people who learn a lot, that would not be a good situation when all others would not be getting well. So as far as the administrative issue is concerned, I would mention that those who work hard have to spend 50 to 70% of their work time to combat with the exterior forces, I would put it this way. And the time, the modern is time is money in the modern economy. What you do not earn today, you will never be able to make up for tomorrow. Well, business in business style of time is money indeed. So you have to value time of other others, so that the time expenses should make it possible for us to concentrate our attention on business. The third item which I would like to mention. So let us consider ethics or morals. Everyone tries to make some money, and so then this money is distributed to among the populations, and everyone is competing to get from the state something, and everyone is discontent. So we should speak politically that to break this vicious circle, we may say that there are people who may work and earn, and to make it the concern of the authorities. And it would be nice, and I know that people, many people share, it would be great that people, those who work, who create jobs or work well, that they should be spoken of, that this is the kind of people who our country needs, and not countries, and not those who do something. Well, you know, it's possible that a person may work the entire day, then throughout his life, but so this is sort of we should, I think, decrease the number of those who live at the expense of others. And I would like to see positive businessmen whose images would be well. And in America, for example, is a country which is an aggressive country. Now we have better relations with them, but they're doing business. And maybe China is another example with a centralized political system where the business moves the country, is a driving force of the country. So the moral of my presentation, intervention, is that our society should stop this psychology of living at the expense of others and would beg less from the government and do more themselves under the conditions that the government creates appropriate condition, environment for that. But if we hope that, if we anticipate that everything will be distributed among everyone, this is a road which will lead us nowhere, and I represent the fertilizer industry. One third of my time I spend, since we produce fertilizers, we have second business grain, and people generate money. So we do not want, so they should not impose ban on the fertilizers. While the crop producers, grain producers, should fight with the government, so they should not be deprived of their income. So make simple rules, make them applicable to all, and stop spending our time on silly things, and make the work of the entrepreneur prestigious one, on the condition that they should pay salaries and taxes. And I want to wish you all, I believe that we do have chances for success. It is simple to do within these walls. In our hard time, we should do business. And I also graduated Moscow State University, and I would like this, that this room should, from this room, students would go to the business and entrepreneurs and only work for themselves, and they will be able to, create the decent living conditions for themselves, working hard. Thank you.
Thank you. Sabko, Sergei Vasilievich is having the floor, the chairman of the State Duma on Industry. That is the man who is taking part in making laws. Thank you. Thank you for a compliment. Yes, a lot has been spoken here. How nice it would be to live nicely. I am also an optimist, and I'm sure that jointly we will support our country. Of course, in 5 minutes, it's hard to lay out a comprehensive program. The first, most important thing for what has been discussed here in terms of raising the economy of the country depends on us. If every participant of this forum, and I'm sure these are active people who are really interested in the future of the country, if together and our loved ones would find the feeling saying that you are a citizen of Russia, and this feeling will help us to unite, and that will be the patriotic effort which would help the country. Here we have a separation of power. We have executive, legislative, and judicial power, and the executive power is not working. Legislative power, they also are the people who are in the state Duma. In Duma, we have the people, active people. We are discussing serious things among yourself and whom we are talking to. When the crisis hit us in 2014, four chairmen of committees came to Madam Nabiulia and talked 4 hours together and what needs to be done. I gave her 9 clauses and she read it and said, yeah, probably you are right, but we have different plans. And now we are the ones who suffer because of these plans. And there was a person in our history, Boris Berezovsky. Why I mention this name? Before the immigration, he made an interview. We created a system which helps us to steal a lot without any chance to be punished. Although the Berezovsky is dead already, but still the system is still existing, and the state continues to use these enterprises and state enterprises, and it looks like it's created to better manage it. But inside, there are commercial organizations, and these commercial structures, they steal money and they make money. And actually, they destroy, let's say, the company manufacturing the parachute systems, and they're basically concerned with making money. And they sell the land, which is owned by this factory. And when the prime minister is reducing the minimum salary level by 200 rubles, saying that the product basket is reduced in price, but at the same time, Gazprom is increasing the wages from $25 million to $27 million in two. And every chairman of the board is receiving a reimbursements of $240 million as a bonus. This is not actually reasonable, and we have to have a government really responsible for what's going on in the country. And what was created is very convenient for the government, and what we discussed today is very important. What we have to create actual mechanisms which will make it possible to use all these ideas and make them happen. We have to change lots of things in culture. We have to have many engineers and lots of soap offers are demonstrating corrupted policemen and everything. Give the possibility to the legislators to appoint the government, which will be a responsible government, so that we could make our plans come true, or not just to meet once a year and to discuss these plans. Thank you, Sergei Vasilievich. Now the floor is given to Mr. Fadeev, the chief editor of Expert magazine and co-coordinated of the party United Russian, the party which is now responsible for the laws. I'm making a pause so that to hear the reaction from the audience. And now the question, and give us the chance. Whom are you turning to? To the people. We have to select and elect those. You will have a chance to win the elections in September to the State Duma. And then the people will give you that chance. If the Election Commission will agree with the people. Yeah, the situation is very serious, but we cannot turn it into the farce. A cheap Young Communist League meeting. When you are a fraction of the State Duma, one of the leading parties of the world. Excuse me, I don't hear what. Let us omit the political issues. Let's talk about the economy. There's no microphone with this lady. So what the problem of today is, yes, now we just heard the Mr. Communist or Comrade Communist. So there is a serious gap. Maybe I'll, will you allow me to continue this conversation? Is it a party meeting or can I continue? Colleagues, let us stop this. And we have an economic forum. We are discussing the economic policy, how to use the potential. Thank you very much. There exists a serious gap. What's made by the federal powers and locally, and you have heard the presentations of the largest entrepreneurs, and if we turn to the regions, 10 days ago, I was in Tumen. Tumen is growing and growing fast, and Mr. Yakushev said that we grow 5 or 6%. The same is in Belgorod region. I know a tremendous growth in agriculture and industry. So those who are working in the regions, the best governors and best companies, they demonstrate growth. So the question arises, why do we have, and Mr. Reinert told us about some successes. And in agriculture, yes, we see the growth, dozens of percent. Why it is not reflected in the federal government? The problem is, I think, that the authorities are led by those who have grabbed this power in the 90s. These are the same people, and they are taking the decisions, especially in the financial and economic blocks, in the central banks. Another part is preparing the decision, the higher school of economy and institution of Gaidar, and others are not allowed to take decisions. Even if you are representing liberal platform, of the United Russia, and we are not allowed to participate mass media, and the group of mass media, which has a certain relationship with economy, and they have specific inclinations. They support those who are preparing and taking and making these decisions effective. And this is very serious. And what could we offer? And I'm talking about the liberal platform, despite of the shouts of all those present. And there is a story when, during the war, Vatican was the idea among the Soviet Union to invite Vatican to the war to participate. And Stalin said, and how many divisions had the Vatican, and what kind of resources we have? Now we are just involved in the intellectual exercises. I agree with that, because the resources are concentrated in the limited circle of people, and this is a democratic problem. And despite of my criticism of communism, the opinion of communists is very important. And of course, political parties, they should have a weight of their own. And that is why I don't share those ungrounded declarations that the election commission may distort the results of the people's elections. I'm not a deputy of the Russian parliament. I believe that the election campaign, which will be led by the political parties, is a very important period. And it gives a serious opportunity to launch this discussion, including United Russia, which is also part of the discussion. And I'm sure it will be severely criticized, because it is the ruling party. And I think we cannot avoid this discussion, and we should participate in those parties which will be part of the State Duma in September. They should have a plan for economic reforms. That's the point which should be in the focus. Thank you. As far as the election campaign, I'll come back to the party issue. And we are representing the party which is called DELO, which was not allowed to participate. So we are not able to take part in this election campaign. One more thing, and all parties are allowed to participate in Primorsky Krai. We took the second place in DELO, and United Russia took all their influence to deprive us of our victory. And today, United Russia is distorting the facts. And when people do not go and vote for them, they switch on the administrative resource. They use teachers, the medical servants. They will not be paid if they do not go voting. Well, of course, let's now go down to the party problems. We are talking about the scenario of economic development, and I would like to ask a question, Mr. Strezhnev and Mr. Kolesnikov. If we leave behind the economic policy and the decision of the authorities, have you seen any obstacle in Russia, in your specific business and in your branch, the lack of money or some resources, difficulties to reach the market, which impedes your development for your business? I represent a big company, an exporter. It's not a typical story. We basically work with the global leading banks. We work with Sberbank, and we do not have any problems with financing due to certain reasons. If we talk about financing, first of all, we always have a right to choose because the balance is nice, and as compared with the small companies, they could use the money only of Sberbank and Rossiljhozbank. But we do have problems on behalf of the government. I'm investor of a small business, and the banks, they have such an instruction that you can put on a pledge 50%. You can put on a pledge your enterprise, but with a discount of 50%. And actually, this is a very unhealthy situation. And if someone wants to get a subsidy, you have to spend half of your working time. Either you are starting to ask every time for the state support and find yourself in the conditions which could not be competitive. And these are the problems of small and medium business. And here we see a situation where a lot of small and medium enterprises are going out of business. Some of them discontinue to pay taxes and go to the shadow. And again, it's a very backward tendency, and something has to be done in this respect. For our branch, it is not typical, the construction materials, and this export is limited. Most of the resources have to be used inside, for we were forced to do that, and the quality of these materials allowed us to do that. We do have two problems. This is the small size of the construction market in Russia, because companies, they do not buy a lot, so that's why we export. It's the way to survive. So we don't have mega profits. And second, the shabby and deteriorating infrastructure, our road system becomes more and more deteriorated. In other, the export tariffs for transport, they have increased. And the second is the deficiency of infrastructure. That's the point I wanted to make. When I was in China and talked to a president of a huge agricultural corporation, we have two criteria. The party sets the mission of high rates of development. You don't have to develop too quickly, for China has limited resources in terms of natural resources and land, and there are certain objective constraints. And second, the people. You cannot develop some kind of a social discontent among the population, social inequality, etc. And these are the problems which you mentioned. This is the problems of economic policy and also deteriorating infrastructure, for the state invests heavily into infrastructure, excellent railroads and airports. It develops in gigantic way. And these political constraints or economic constraints are being solved and could not be considered to be an obstacle.
So I would like to ask yet another question to Mr. Reinert. You say that Russia is integrated into the world economy, and if we start to support our domestic industry, domestic agriculture, that may result in a negative response of our from our trade partners. We will start compete with them, and that Well, it's fearful to become, we will become less, say, attractive for our neighbors. Do you see from the West any fears, any concern about potential economic development of Russia? Do they look at that with a fear, with some apprehension? Is there an issue between Russia? What kind of Russia is the Russia needed by the West? A developed Russia or underdeveloped Russia?
Well, in 1990, a gentleman which was the head of Brown Boveri Corporation, Swiss company, said, well, when these Russians come, what should we do? Should we throw bread at them or should we shoot them? You know, this is 1990, right? And the obvious third reply to that is make sure they produce their bread themselves, right? And I think there is some kind of a parallel story here with Germany being punished after World War I, right? And that punishment went too far. And I think there's a parallel here with the punishment of Russia, in a sense. You know, the shock therapy, that was also a punishment that went too far. Right? So I think any Westerner who thinks long-term doesn't want a poor Russia. You know, if you want economic stability, you want a big middle class. And in order to create a big middle class, well, you need a diversified economy and manufacturing. So I think the fear is not for an economically strong Russia, or it shouldn't be. The worry is more on the military side, and if we look at the short 20th century, there was a globalization coming up to the middle of the century, then you got this marginalization of Germany, and then you got some two terrible decades, 1930s and 1940s, and in 1947. There was the Marshall Plan, there was the Havana Charter, which had understood that everyone needed to develop their own manufacturing industry, right? So my wish for a short version of the 21st century is that we go from 1916 to 1947 without the 1930s and 40s. And I think this is, in order to do that, we have to make Russia richer. And we have to make the periphery of the European Union richer. I think you may not see it from here, but how serious the falling real wages is in the periphery of the European Union. I mean, not only Greece, but also Italy, Portugal, Spain. You know, this is serious. In the 90s, Russia was alone with these things. Now the West is coming after. And I think that's an interesting thing. And that's where you should steer, not from the rear window, but for the future. And I think what's happening in America, that America is turning for the kind of protectionism that Russia should have turned for in the 1990s, you know, I think this is very interesting. I think this is politically very interesting, and I think that the world is, you know, the concept of the world is changing from globalization to something more complicated, just as it did around 1900. When England was leading, and now it's the United States. So I think the fear of an economically strong Russia is it would only be if it's military only. I mean, it's not for the rest of the economy.
Well, about military aspect, I would not quite understand. Well, do we mean that Russia will go to a military conquer Europe? Was this something unbelievable, I think?
I'm a simple...
I would like to make a few comments in this respect. First of all, I would like to wish all of us to read the article of Albert Einstein of 1949, why socialism? It's very topical today. Secondly, my neighbor to the left said that foultry and high tech is not something which we need. I think this is a special approach. High tech are needed everywhere be it in poultry or in agriculture, in, say, raw material branches in the agriculture. I often go to travel to Belarus, and I remember when I come to one of the milk farms there near Nestlezh, and I was very surprised by the cleanliness of the production. That milk farm was number one across the entire European section of the economy in terms of the number of liters of milk produced. And I think Belarus can show us an example in terms of development of agriculture. Let me say a few words about the State Duma. Parliament of Russia. You say, right, that an interrupted production of laws is a nightmare. It's a violation of all democratic principles. This, in fact, when you take laws regulating each and every aspect of your life, that means that we are being forced to live in a specific way. In fact, we need only basic laws, basic rules, and then rules are adopted depending on the situation, depending on the specific region. So I have spoken about that a lot. Even addressing the State Duma, I am not a party member, but I have been as a member of the communist, say, a party fraction, because it's only the only fraction which fights for the development of agriculture, science, education, culture, and which define the development of the civilization. I do remember when one of my old men, Stephen Chu, who was a minister of energy for USA, because he was with Obama during his first tenure, but later he left the administration, saying that he is disgusted with the speculation of the government. And he quoted me words of the Minister of Energy of Saudi Arabia, because the Stone Age ended not because the deficit of stone arrived. And the oil century will not come not because there will deficit of oil. The change of civilization take place due to creation of principally new technologies, which are generated due to the development of science. And the Russian scientific and technological potential has always been very high, and it was necessary. It is necessary to support it, not only because this is the key road of development, but this is also, it will bring benefits for us today. For a wide majority of population, they want to make, it's very good what you do in Spassky and Primorsky region, but as far as land is concerned, I want to say the private ownership on land is, you know, something bad inheritance from the Middle Ages. This is not something which should be done. This should be, when the private ownership of land, especially in our conditions, generates and interrupted speculations. They say that nobody, Western companies do not come to us. Well, with rent, what you're going to produce here, they will come. Don't worry about that. And it's something which we should accomplish. And at the final count, read Albert Einstein. He was a very wise man. Thank you.
I'm definitely in favor of science, and I think the quote about the Stone Age and not ending because of running out of stone, you know, that's just the way I think. And, you know, in the 1880s, the English thought the world would come to an end because they would run out of coal, right? And they didn't. And the same thing with gas. The problem is that high tech does not produce enough jobs alone. You have also to promote the industries that use that high tech. I mean, not only Skolkovo, but the marmalade factories that use the technology which is developed in Skolkovo. And I think here, Belarus is an excellent example. You know, Belarus is doing fairly well because they kept a very diversified industry. Belarus has a very different economic structure than the rest of the former Soviet republics because it managed to keep that diversification. So I don't, you know, you may think we disagree, but we don't. But it can be too much, you know, California is living off Silicon Valley, but the rest of the United States also needs those industries that use the technology which is developed in Silicon Valley. And I think the same thing applies to Skolkovo. That's all.
Thank you. We have a few minutes for the audience to start questions. One question, please. May I ask a question? Strezhnev, and then you, and then we'll end the wind up. I want to ask about science. Coming back to the science, when people say that some takes place in the Russian, we should understand that there are wars and there are deeds. What are deeds? What is the life like? In Russia, we used to have, I was a student of physicists, and when I was a student, we used to go to various professors, and we had teachers who treat as gods, as authorities, and we had an activity which should transform science into technology, which in fact was destroyed right now. I mean, high-tech equipment is nowhere present in our laboratories. So right now, when we say that the government is likely to address it, the government is reforming the Academy of Sciences. The government is doing something else. But who wants to go to the Russian productive company, with the exception of Gazprom? Or who would want to go and work in a research institute where what our scientists do when we come to them for the practical science? They copy, say, articles written back to the Soviet Union. They reprint, translated articles from English, and they lack the connections with practical production. So we construct a lot, and we buy a lot. So we have 3,000 our own construction workers. We have our own design institute and prospecting company. This is something which we should be concerned with. If we do not have a business which is, concerned about the innovative technologies, then the science will not be required by all. And if there are countries going along the path of progress, Japan, Switzerland, China, the progress is implemented at small and mid-sized enterprises when people spend their own funds and know how to make money by spending their money. Then the science will be a great fundamental science, and all plants, as our industrializations, we have 80% of our plants bought abroad. So our science works for the defense sector, and this is a key problem. Do not forget about business, because science without money is spent money, and government should also think about that. Thank you. I would also make a comment. I partially agree with what you say, but you do not know the current status in many of our scientific laboratories, and you do not treat correctly the situation when we have fundamental science in the Soviet Union, and now everything was what? It is not true. All military-related industries, everything was created by domestic scientists based on the achievements by Russian scientists. And today, come to my university. I will show you the best in Europe Center of Molecular Epitaxis, where you see the latest technologies. And what you are right in, Russian business does not want to risk. This is true. And then we work, that's true, with Germany, with China. Americans cooperate with us, and this is bad. This is good for us. In the beginning of the 90s, the finance provided to the Academy of Sciences was diminished, but we were saved by the international scientific cooperations. We established international scientific cooperation, and those ties continue right now. That's true, someone has left, but ties remain. What is important, that the domestic business should take a risk in starting startup companies. They create in a very prospective jurisprudence. We're outside of the times, but this is a risk, but which businessmen should take. Thank you. Okay, let us take one question from the audience, and then we will be done. This is the third time that they participate in this forum. Every time I say about what the problem we have in the Prekopere region, speaking about at our forum, but at the government level, departure from the. I want to ask a question. One question. Jerez Ivanovich, I want to ask you a question. The government has taken a decision to extract in the National Park of Zakopere nickel and copper. I would want to appeal to Jerez Ivanovich. Okay. So I want just. My response can be having. I can give you this question. Only I have studied the material. Before I start studying materials, I have brought the letter. I will give it to my letter. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for a very engaging discussion. Thank you for giving me a chance to ask a question. I think the question I'd like to ask will be this is a question to Valeriy Fadeev. And you're a person who has direct relations. What should we do, all of us in this room, so that we should be heard, so that the measures should be taken by the government, and we should not have corruption and everything else? If you follow the expert magazines and my work in the United Russia, this is something which we're doing. We're trying to establish these channels of communications between business, successful regions, successful municipalities, and upper echelons of our executive authorities. And there is such a communication is listening. This is a great issue. This is a issue of the elite, of emasculated elite, and this is a fundamental issue. This is something which I try to get across in my presentation. And if we fail to do that within the next 5 or 7 years, then we're in for difficult times. Thank you all for a very engaging discussion.